Blackstone Publishing presents In the Cauldron, Terror, Tension, and the American Ambassador's Struggle to Avoid Pearl Harbor by Lew Paper. This book is read by Robertson Dean. For Ellie and Charlie, may they prosper in a world without war. Chapter 1. Anticipation. It was, in many ways, a typical Sunday afternoon at the White House. The president, dressed casually in flannel slacks and a gray pullover sweater that once belonged to his eldest son, Jimmy, was working on his stamp collection, a lifelong passion, behind the small wooden desk in the second-floor oval study. The president loved that room. The high ceilings, the assorted knick-knacks on the desk and tables, the lion skin on the floor, and the built-in bookshelves conveyed a warmth missing in the larger and more formal rooms of the mansion. Model ships were displayed on various tables, and scattered on the tan-colored walls were oil paintings and other art depicting sailing vessels from long ago, all reflecting another passion of the president's, the sea. In earlier times, he had loved the exhilaration of sailing and was in fact struck down by polio in August 1921 while on a family visit at Campobello, Maine, where sailing was a principal activity. That love of the sea was not confined to leisure activities. He had treasured his service as Assistant Secretary of the Navy in President Woodrow Wilson's administration more than 20 years earlier. It was probably no small coincidence that the leather sofa and chairs in the study were once used on the USS Mayflower, which had served as a presidential yacht during the tenure of his cousin Theodore Roosevelt, who had been Assistant Secretary of the Navy in President William McKinley's administration. The appeal of the oval study was enhanced by its proximity to his bedroom. The bedroom, which he did not share with his wife Eleanor, was next to the study, a point of particular importance for a man who had to rely on a wheelchair for mobility. Arthur Prettyman, the large black man and a retired Navy chief petty officer, had served as the president's valet since 1939, and he probably would have entered the bedroom sometime shortly after 8 a.m. on that Sunday morning. Prettyman would generally stay with the president as he sat up in the narrow bed and went through his morning ritual, eating breakfast, typically orange juice, eggs, bacon, and toast, along with coffee that he made himself, while poring through a stream of newspapers, usually the New York Times, the New York Herald Tribune, the Washington Post, the Baltimore Sun, and others. In these private moments with his valet, the president almost always displayed an amiable, sweet disposition that made him seem immune to the burdens of the office. He was very fond of Prettyman, and the two would often engage in light banter as the morning progressed. The president liked to tease Prettyman about his good looks and would invariably refer to him as a lady killer, which prompted the valet to respond that, "One does not refute the chief executive, Mr. President." It is doubtful that anyone had a more intimate relationship with Franklin D. Roosevelt at the time than Prettyman. He assisted the president with dressing, using the bathroom, and bathing, although Roosevelt liked to shave himself, and the valet performed those chores wherever the president went. But the valet was a master of discretion, and rarely would he disclose details about the man he served. Later, after he and Roosevelt had died, Prettyman's widow would answer inquiries about what her husband knew by saying that he didn't talk to us about anything. However much he may have appreciated Prettyman's company and the unobstructed view of the Washington Monument outside his bedroom window, Roosevelt's thoughts on that first Sunday morning in December 1941 surely drifted to the expected armed conflict with Japan. Sometime around 9:30 p.m. on the prior Saturday evening, Lieutenant Lester Scholes, an aide to Roosevelt's naval attaché, had given him the first 13 parts of a highly confidential 14-part memorandum that had been transmitted by the Japanese government to its ambassador in Washington. The ambassador would later be instructed to give the entire memorandum to Secretary of State Cordell Hull at 1 p.m. on that first Sunday in December, but American intelligence sources had intercepted the first 13 parts of the memorandum on Saturday after it was transmitted to the Japanese embassy, and they would soon intercept the last part. The memorandum was an ostensible reply to a prior proposal of the United States in the ongoing discussions that Hull and Roosevelt had been having with Japan's representatives. Roosevelt already suspected that the Japanese would make a surprise attack somewhere. And now,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.